So actually, I'm a German who recently moved to Switzerland, so I do try to be on Swiss time. I was asked to talk about the suction-assisted laryngoscopy and airway decontamination technique. I'm pretty sure most of you will be aware of the technique, so I will especially focus on some pitfalls and indications for the technique. I have no conflict of interest. I always thought talking about vomit is a very niche topic, but I was made aware it's apparently not. There are some researchers in Denmark currently investigating some 666 million-year-old fish vomit. But let's talk serious. Fluids or bloods have been identified in a very recent meta-analysis to be the most predictive factor for a bad first-pass success rate in a pre-hospital intubation. And actually, it reduces the likelihood of first-pass success by around 51%. So this is the reason why we just need to be aware about fluids or blood in the airway and need to have a technique to handle those issues. One technique for this was proposed by Dr. Jim DeCanto is the salvage technique, and it's a simple six-step technique. And what often is overlooked is that the actual aim of the salvage technique is not to suction clear the airway. The aim is to keep the optics or your light source clean so that you actually have in view and can intubate a patient. So the first step is an overhand grip, to hold the suction catheter in an overhand grip to be able to follow the curve of the airway and suck. And we also use the rigid suction catheter sort of like a laryngoscope to make space to put in the laryngoscope. And we always lead with suction so that we keep our optics clean. So the motto is stay high and dry. And I show you a few videos. This video is a patient who has been intubated on the beach. He drowned. And the intubator just shoves in the laryngoscope, and he is able to see. And he's able to see because the gastric content is just seawater. But let's just compare it to intubation from the emergency department. This is a patient with an upper GI bleed, and even after having watched this video 20 times, it still gives me goose skin because the operator is now not able to see because there's so much blood in the airway. And he just missed to use a rigid suction catheter first. So, after we lead with suction, we place our rigid suction catheter on the left side so that we have space on the right side for tube delivery. And we might amend our technique when the source of the fluid is the esophagus. Then we stick the catheter into the esophagus. If the source of the fluid might be the airway, we may want to park the suction catheter 1 or 2 centimeters in front of the trachea so that all that pulmonary edema can be sucked away and away from the laryngoscope. This is followed by tracheal intubation, and we might want to do the so-called salad perk maneuver, which just means that we put our finger next to the laryngoscope blade to just put a bit more midline, a bit more to the left side, so that we have enough space on the right side to put in our bougie and our tube. And the last step is just suctioning the endotracheal tube. So this is basically the technique, and I promise that we talk about salad pitfalls. And I think there are a few. The first one, which we often do not talk about, is just forgetting the goal. I know salad is fun. There's some blood in a mannequin or in a real patient that might be really tricky to deal with. What we often tend to do is we just forget the goal. So for example, this patient here with pulmonary edema, the intubator is very proficiently suctioning all the fluids away, but there's just more and more and more coming. And this patient just requires a tube between the vocal cords and some positive pressure ventilation and PEEP. And the more you suck, the more is coming. So when you train, you need to have a cognitive stop point where you just think, okay, now I'm at a point where I see good enough to get a tube in and intubate. The next issue is, which is often not talked about, sucking soft tissues. So example, this intubation here, you might not actually be able to really good see it here on the screen, is that the catheter is actually suctioning the uvula, which can cause some trauma. Or in this intubation here, the suction catheter is actually just stuck on the soft tissue and causes some hematoma. And it may irritate you if you have a second look that there will be some hematoma in the airway. You just need to have this in mind that this can happen. And the last topic or the last pitfall I want to talk about is not utilizing suction at all. What we do know is that around 1/3 of all prehospital tracheal intubations have some fluids or blood in the airway. What we also know is that the salvage technique is effective. We also know that blood or fluid in the airway will reduce first-pass success. Just the question is when to use the cellar technique. Of course, when we have some blood coming out of the airway, we'll directly use this technique. But should we use it maybe for all intubations? I think this is the next research question which we should look at. So thank you very much for your time. I say a special thanks to Jim, Claire, Cliff, and Christian, who provided some nice images. There's a QR code going to the Protected Airway course learning space on cellar technique. And you also find those posters upstairs when you train it. Thank you very much.